Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the Menifee City Council Workshop for this evening. Madam Clerk, I believe we have all council members present.
That is correct and so noted.
Thank you kindly. And Mr. Johnson, take us where you want us to go.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, members of council. Very excited tonight to hand this over to your to our Engineering Public Works Department team. For an update on Holland Road overcrossing, it's obviously one of our top seven infrastructure projects built in the middle of our $100 million CIP five-year project. We're right on time, right on schedule. And, you know, we've been talking about Newport since we've been doing Newport. We've been talking about Menifee Road Missing Link. We were talking about Newport Road Widening Project. Two of those are done, one's in the middle, and we're getting ready specifically to get excited about Holland Road overcrossing. I'm going to hand it over to Jonathan Smith, the Director of Public Works, and he'll have the balance of the item and introduce his team that's working on the project.
Thank you, City Manager. Tonight, Nino Abad, the senior engineer in the CIP department, has a short presentation to start the workshop off. Nino is assisted by two members of our design consultant team, TY Lynn International. With that, I'll turn it over to Nino to introduce the rest of the team.
Good evening, Mayor Mann.
Good evening.
Members of the council. So we have the Holland Road overcrossing workshop.
Excuse me, can you flip up the microphone a little bit closer so we get it on record? Thank you.
They're working on it right now. There we go. Had to warm up.
We're going to try a quick reset here.
It's coming up, looks like.
Yours is.
Oh, that's a good idea. Let's turn it off. Okay, do you want me to do the others, Rob?
Let's hit this button.
Turn your screen off and then on again.
Kathy, yours isn't showing though.
I did that.
I think they're on, don't you think?
Went back to yellow, see? There's no signal.
Okay, there, woo, you had it.
Showing perfect online.
But something's unhooked.
There it is.
All right, let me go.
How about we make some copies of the slide presentation and.
Okay.
So the council has copies in front of them.
All right, I'm going under the counter here. That was fun.
Well, as everybody disappears underneath the dais and we look for more information, we can talk a little bit in general about the Holland Road overcrossing and provide a little bit of information. As I mentioned earlier, we're right on schedule. We're looking at where our financing components are, and we're right on schedule to be fully funded for this. I will say that some of the issues that are going through the state right now that the governor is proposing for the transportation bill that is that he's working on, the transportation fix, the $6 billion he's looking for, will be a definite help to us as we move forward. But in no way should we consider that a drastic need for additional funding for the Holland Road overcrossing. We have, as well, some funds set aside for TUMF for the Newport Road interchange. As you recall, we put about $19 million of our own local money, and you leverage that to get a $14 million grant. So the construction of Newport is really been handled by the City of Menifee, which is pretty exciting. So of that $19 million, I believe there's $10 to $13 million set aside by WRCOG and the TUMF program. That should be coming back to the city, which we could then use for other projects that are on the TUMF network, and Holland Road overcrossing is on the TUMF network. So, Nino, while we're trying to figure out what's going on with our video, why don't you go ahead and start your presentation, and we'll catch up and ask questions. And if we look to the left and right, We can see those overheads beside us, and I'm sure that the copies will be coming soon. So please proceed.
So what's on your desk right now is the handout, which has some of the renderings that we'll be talking about through the presentation. So you already have that available. So we're going to provide an update to Council on the progress of the Holland Road Overcrossing Project and introduce and discuss the aesthetic treatment options. We'll go over the project team members, the purpose of the project, project timeline, project aesthetics, and then we'll be having a future public open house. So the project team, obviously, Jonathan Smith, myself, we're being assisted by Carlos Geronimo, who's our associate engineer here at the City of Menifee. And from TOLN, we have Clark Fernan, Jim Rucker, who's here today. Robert Barton's here as well. He's our primary contact with TOLN, and Jeff Kim. So the purpose of the project is to improve safety and mobility for the residents of the City of Menifee by providing an additional east-west I-215 overcrossing and reduce congestion at existing Newport Road. The project scope...
Excuse me, you need to come right up into the mic so we can hear you through the speakers because we are recording this.
Okay.
Thanks.
The project scope will construct, construct a new four-lane overcrossing at Holland Road that will span over I-215 and Antelope Road. We will realign Willowood Way, restripe Hanover and Albion Lanes, construct an access road for industrial business, and relocate essential utilities. This will improve the traffic circulation, save approximately 12,500 trips on Newport Road, save over 7,000 trips on Hahn, save over 14,000 trips on Scott Road. The project scope will improve level of service at over 9 intersections, including Newport, Hahn, Scott, Menifee, and Antelope. So you can see here the existing aerial and the approximate location of the overcrossing. You can see the area by the Cantabria Apartments. That was set aside for this project, so that was planned even within their construction. And one of the most important things to know about Holland, as it is different from Newport and Scott and McCall, is that those are existing. And therefore, you know, some of the impacts there, you know, already, we're just widening it basically. Here we're adding new abutments near the apartments and the residents to the south of Holland. And so we wanted to go over some additional aesthetic treatments on there because they'll have more interaction and that but those abutments will have more visibility for us. So with that, I will turn it over to Jim.
Thanks, Nino. Jim Rucker from TOLN International. I just want to update you briefly, as the city manager said, on the timeline. The project was initiated by City Council in April of 2014. Between April and October of 2014, we submitted and were approved for a streamlined oversight process through Caltrans District 8. So that goes all the way up to the district director to get their concurrence. And so we were able to get that. And that's really going to bear a lot of fruit as far as expediting the reviews from the Caltrans oversight level. We took that preliminary approvals for a streamlined oversight and we prepared the geometrics for the projects, which were approved in April of this year. After the geometrics are approved, we go up to Sacramento and we do a what's called a structure type selection. So we present our proposed structure to the Caltrans oversight people and we get their buy-in so that there's no going back as we start our final design. So that was achieved just in June of this year. And we went ahead and submitted the 65% set of the design plans just last month in July. So those are currently in review both at the city level and at the district level. And we again are still anticipating the groundbreaking for construction in spring of 2016, which is right on schedule. We have a slide in here, and if you can't see it, then it's probably not that big a loss, but we want to just give you an example. This is this is what the plans look like for the bridge itself. It is an engineering drawing, of course, but as Nino mentioned, what's different about this project is it spans the I-215 and the abutments or the ends of the structure land in a residential neighborhood. So we obviously are going to have a lot of attention to that and how that interacts with the public, in particular on the east side near the apartment complex that Nino mentioned. So we're going to talk a little bit more about the aesthetics on that east side and give you some ideas of things that we were thinking, and I'm going to ask Rob Barton to come up and talk about that.
Thank you, Jim, and thank you for taking some time to meet with us today. Some of the concepts that we're developing for the aesthetics for the Holland Road project include variations of options. And what I want to stress today is we're presenting you these options in hopes of springboarding ideas and to maybe determine if a preference goes one way or another, if there's something that sort of strikes you as something that is interesting. And we can take those veins and sort of explore those a little bit more carefully for the upcoming next presentations as the schedule moves along. So these are conceptual options we're offering you. Hopefully they're good ideas, things you can take and process and discuss internally, and give us some concepts of what you think might work. And so what you'll see here is just one of the general concepts of what will happen on the bridge. It's just a general bridge lighting concept. And the first item that you'll see in the top left is basically what's considered to be a Caltrans standard pedestal and a Caltrans standard light. These are obviously the more cost-effective options, and that's aesthetically what it would look like. And inside the barrier is a treatment. It's called a dry stack texture. And the nice thing about that treatment is it matches the corridor plan through the 215 in Menifee. It matches what's shown on Newport and Scott Road as well. So you'll get a continuity of aesthetics through the system. But some of the other lighting options that you'll see there is we've done an angular design, a revised pedestal. It's something that's a little bit more aesthetically pleasing beyond the Caltrans standard, and it integrates a little bit better with the fencing that you'll see adjacent to that. And then, of course, the bottom right one is the aesthetic concept that will also match what's shown on Newport and Scott Road as well. So you can see something similar to that. It's a more advanced option. It's got a little bit more investment in terms of the aesthetics cost-wise with both the lighting and the concrete treatment that's on the side. So you can sort of see those and get a feel for what those look like and what you like about those. Going more into what will be the more important aesthetic treatment, which will be the treatment of the walls, which will be adjacent to the residences on the east side. We're presenting a few options, trying to start with a simple, cost-effective, yet durable and a little bit timeless of an option, which is called a fractured rib texture. The nice thing about that texture is it actually has a relief backwards and forwards of a matter of inches. And so it presents something that's more than just a blank slate. It's a very good graffiti deterrent, and it also provides a visual breakup of just a solid wall. There's a variant of that option just below that on the bottom left. And I don't want to use the word mural, but basically it's a modified natural texture. And that can be achieved by either staining the concrete or by recessing or not recessing the concrete in those reliefs to provide a pattern. And that pattern that we're showing here is a mountainscape. It's basically just our artist and our in-house architect's interpretation of the beautiful landscape and mountainside that you see here at the City of Menifee. You can see it in the seal of the City of Menifee as well. And then we tried to get a little creative. We wanted to come up with some more creative options, some more interesting options, and then even some of the discussions that we had with Caltrans, there's the potential for like a geometric green wall, and that's presented there in the advanced geometric pattern. And then something that's a little bit even more advanced upon that, which is we call it a quartz concept. These are both very advanced concepts, things you might not have seen before, very customized, and of course, unfortunately, with a customized wall comes a little bit added cost, but we wanted to show you the spectrum of aesthetics that you'd be able to decide from, and again, these are hopefully launching points for things that you prefer or don't prefer. And so this would be the view looking south from Antelope Road, just north of the existing Holland Road. And you'd see the Cantabria apartments there on the side. This is a little bit of a detailed view of those textures. As you can see, the top left one is that fractured rib texture. And those panels you see are actually the panels that are part of the wall. And so the bottom left one maintains that same geometric grid for those wall panels, but it has that relief and that texture showing the mountainscape in that aspect. And then, of course, the creative options are shown there on the right, which is the advanced geometric pattern in that quartz concept. Those would need to be integrated into a design, and so what you see there might not necessarily be the final product, but it's our artist's rendering of what you would see. From the other side of the road, which is from the south side of the existing Holland Road, the future Willowood Way, looking north, this would be the sidewalk area and that existing Holland, soon to be Willowood Way corner. And it shows those same features of the wall, the standard feature, the fractured rib texture, integrated with some of the landscape architecture that we're planning, as well as those mountainscapes and the geometric patterns that we're anticipating. And you can see, so we're integrating some of those concepts with the landscape architecture to try and create a visual barrier that would be a little bit more aesthetically pleasing for the residences and the pedestrians in the area. So this is ties in that landscape architecture, and this is a large outscale view. Hopefully, you know, we can have some boards here we can show you in detail. But what you'll see on the west side, which is from Hahn Road to the 215 freeway, is really the area where there's some slopes that can be decorated and some areas around there that can be treated. And the nice thing is there's already a very good landscape concept along Hahn Road as you're traveling along. You've seen the trees on the side and the sidewalks. And so we would integrate that same concept coming around onto that west side of Holland Road, the trees and the sidewalk concept. There'd be mixed in features as well. And those features we're hoping will provide a very good value in terms of providing something aesthetically to you. But the nice thing about the landscape architecture treatment we're featuring is it'll be drought tolerant. Obviously right now we have got a significant drought going on, and so being water wise is very smart. Also using things in the area that are native rock, native plants that would match the existing areas. And also to provide something for you that's low maintenance, so also with low maintenance comes low cost. Matching the existing architecture in the area and to provide something that's durable for you. And so we provided a little bit of a color scheme that's in there, and then there's some surrounding areas that match. And looking to the east side, the areas that are adjacent to the residences, there's also that same landscape concept that you have trailing north and south along Antelope Road, with the palm trees that are in there and then the hedges that are along the side. And we'll be tying in and integrating those to the landscape architecture plan as well. So one of the next items that we have coming up is a public open house that we'll be presenting some of these items as well. And we've also got an upcoming 90% submittal for design, and being able to get your feedback and get your concepts and your preferences will definitely help us guide to the right direction that we want to go so that we can maintain the design process and stay on schedule. So we wanted to organize this meeting with you, and thank you for taking some time to discuss this with us. So some of the things that I want you to keep in mind for the discussion are the visual enhancements, the accessibilities, the safety, coordinating with the other structures, Newport and Scott Road, and then also maintaining the look and feel of the aesthetics for the city of Menifee. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much for your presentation. And this is a really exciting project for our city. What is it, CIP project number 3 or 4 in the overall scheme? What do you have it numbered?
I think it's
fourth. I think it's 4. Council, got any comments on the designs and the aesthetics? Mr. Liesmeyer?
I didn't hear anybody talk about environmental. Where's everything out of the environmental process?
So the environmental process, we're actually in the process of submitting the draft ISMND right now. It's approximately 50 to 60% of the way through the process, and we're working hand in hand with Caltrans right now, and so far the approvals have been coming along very well.
Initial study mitigated negative deck.
And where we're standing is because of the funding sources, the project is actually a CEQA only project right now. There's no federal component to it, which actually helps maintain the schedule for what we're looking for.
So you're looking for some feedback from us tonight on the aesthetics of the lighting and maybe the abutments, you said?
That's correct.
Do you have any, guys have any comments about that tonight? Generally, I mean, I think if I can go back to one of the slides about the pedestals, the pedestal lights. Thank you. Is it the pedestal lights for the for Newport and Scott? Is that going to be the design for those?
I believe on the bottom right is the Newport design for the pedestal with it looks like an acorn.
Yeah,
I think that's what we're going for.
With the teacup type of light?
Correct.
So for me personally, just my point of view, I think it should match. It should match the corridor. It should match Newport Road, and we carry that same design through to Scott.
Agreed.
And in terms of the, I like the idea of getting the community involved absolutely on the abutment scheme, but I'm sure that there's a cost component. But from a practical standpoint, my point of view would be whatever helps us not only prevent graffiti, but if graffiti happens, it's easily correctable without a lot of cost to it. And so I kind of like the natural landscape thing just from one point of view, but I don't want to poison my friends who live over there in that neighborhood, miss the Iries over here, because I'm sure they're going to have ideas on the design since they live right up the street. But man, I'm excited about this. Shovels in the ground by spring. Wow, that's exciting stuff right there. Mr. Johnson.
If I could just get a clarification on the design itself, as the bridge crosses over 215, is on the east side, is that actually going to be a tunnel across Antelope?
The bridge will continue to span over the 215 and over Antelope as well.
Okay, so there's going to be no wall between Antelope and the 215?
That's correct.
Okay, great.
Good. Yeah.
There's a series of columns that are shown right there, okay. But they are outside the limits of Antelope Road.
Fantastic.
But is there currently access to Willowwood Way from Holland Road?
Yes, just to the east of the Antelope Holland interchange, there's a driveway that continues on the south side of Holland Road that goes into Willowwood Way.
So this project will cut that off?
The project will continue that same direction, and the old Holland Road will now become, in that area, the new Willowwood Way. And Willowwood Way will continue from that same intersection to the west and tie into Antelope Road.
Right, but to the east, will there be access to Holland Road from Willowwood Way, like there is now?
Julie's pulling up the landscape slide here, which I think shows exactly what you're seeing. It's the other way, sorry.
Was that one?
Yeah, that one
down. Oh, I thought there was a different one which showed all the landscaping. It's a little bit easier because it doesn't have both. Doesn't have half. You keep going a little bit.
That's the second to last slide.
Oh. Second to last slide. We're almost there. You go. You can see that Willowwood Road there on the bottom left on the east side is Holland currently, and you can see where the Holland Road Bridge lands, and it takes up Holland Road. But it leaves Willowwood to turn into the complex. Is that what you're referring to?
Well, if you go back to the slide that you had up there before, where you have current and proposed. There you go. So the existing Holland Road, you can see that there's Willowwood Way access from Holland Road now. On the far right on the east side, correct? And so that'll be closed off with the new construction. And is there any ROW acquisition on this, or for those row of homes right there? Or is that already in the existing right-of-way for the city?
I think there might be a little bit of right-of-way acquisition as the boundary towards the corner mm-hmm. of Holland. But at Cantabria, it was conditioned with that space for Holland.
Right, but I'm talking about the homeowners on the south.
There would be some.
Yeah.
Yes, sliver takes.
You're saying yes and you're saying no.
For right away? No. Okay. No.
Okay. You want to have a tie-breaking vote on that? Mr. Liesmeyer?
Are we doing any sort of sound walls or anything like that on those properties on Willowwood Way, or is there a concern about any noise or anything like that to those neighbors? I mean, I guess a sound wall is probably not realistic. It'd have to be 30 feet high to make any sense, right? So,
yeah, we might have to do some sound walls. We're doing the noise study, and I think that'll be completed shortly. So we'll have to evaluate that. Mostly it's going to be towards the Holland at Hanover area.
Okay.
Where the bridge is down at grade.
And then, Jonathan, I just want to make sure you're comfortable reviewing the plans. You don't need any extra bodies to review the city, from the city's perspective for the plans on the overpass and stuff. You're good?
No, we're currently staffed quite well to handle this project. But just back to the walls, they're still evaluating the need for the walls, and once the study is complete, then we'll be able to provide additional information on that.
What's your timing on needing responses on the aesthetics?
I think what's our timing for this?
Our next submittal is October.
So our next submittal to Caltrans will be around October. We submitted 65% plans a couple weeks ago, so probably in the next few weeks.
Mr. Johnson?
So the plan was to share this, obviously, with council tonight and then have an open house with the public on August 18th. We have that listed here, gathering both not only information from the public, which then we could send out to council so that council has an idea of what the public's looking for and wants to see. And then that input could be further given. What we're trying to avoid is getting to the point where we have a really good design and almost a final copy, and then someone comes up with a really good idea. Mm-hmm. So in order to keep our timeline for what we stated in our CIP, we're kind of moving this along rather quickly, and we understand that we're bringing this to you at 65%, and we're kind of asking, hey, how do you think 90%, what do you think 90% is going to look like? But I think the team has done a really good job in giving some ideas on aesthetic design. They'll take the same ideas that we brought here and show those to the public. I don't think anything's going to come out of left field, because I think if it does, it really raises our cost to the point where it may make it infeasible to move forward in the spring. So we'll do the best we can and take all the input we can and make the best decision to move forward on what the design will look like.
Getting it done and staying on our timeline is paramount, I think. And we can accomplish those aesthetic inputs from the community and from the council and make it go, I think, based upon what you've got scheduled. Do you have a concern about what if you don't have a good turnout on August 18th? Do you have enough time to hold another a community forum if you need to, heading into October's submission?
I think we can do that. We can work something out, because I think we're going to do 95% somewhere around January, so we can adjust the schedule a little bit.
This is such a key project for our city. I don't think you'll not have input from the community. I think it'll be well attended, provided we really advertise it well.
Yeah, we decided to have the community meeting at Mount San Jacinto, so it's closer to the neighborhood most impacted.
Sure.
And we'll provide direct notices to Cantabria and the neighborhood to the south.
Okay. And, well, I would say we need to do some outreach eastward into some of those other neighborhoods. I mean, we do notices for public hearings at, 1,000 feet or 300 feet? What do we do? It's 1,000? It's 300?
It's 300, yeah.
I just think in this particular case, we need to expand it eastward a little bit beyond that, beyond Cantabria and beyond the development to the south. Country gardens, yeah.
Okay, we could certainly do that.
And if they don't show, but at least they'll not be able to come up and stand where you're standing and you didn't give us a chance to give an input on it.
There are HOAs and property associations that we can notify. We can notify Valleywide, have those in their facilities, leased by leaflet, and then we can direct mail out. So we can kind of hit it both ways. We can put something in the newspaper, in the Press Enterprise, or Menifee 24/7, which is our real reach. So I think we'll put that out. We can do an e-newsletter. We've got several thousand on that. I think we probably missed Menifee Matters. But we'll we'll definitely take what you've said into consideration and make sure that we get more out than what we had planned on.
All right. Thanks, Mr. Johnson. Mr. Denver.
On the bottom picture, the blue drawing, the what do you want to call it, the blue above Holland Road there, what is that exactly? Is that a road? Is that a dirt?
That's, if you see on the existing over there, there's a channel that's kind of has a loose S shape. That's a realignment of that channel to accommodate the overcrossing.
So it's an over, it's water course?
Correct. We believe that's actually like the old Paloma Wash.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mr. Liesemeyer.
Last question, I promise. I assume both Hanover and Hahn are going to be getting signals out of this project?
Correct.
I'm just mildly concerned about how we're going to deal with Hahn Road. If you're coming south and you get a green light, hypothetically, how that curve in that road runs through there. There's been a lot of accidents there. I mean, people driving through there at night, not seeing the intersection, maybe not seeing the stop sign and not navigating that curve correctly and spinning across the road and whatnot. Just are we doing any extra lighting north and south? Well, north is already lit because of the channel work, but going south, is there any extra lighting being added to the shoulder to light the road heading south?
So is your concern northbound or southbound on Hahn?
Southbound on Hahn.
Southbound on Hahn.
Yeah. So you go through the intersection and you forget to turn to the right and you just overcorrect and spin out. You know, there's plenty of skid marks over to back up what I'm talking about.
Yeah, we can look at that. We can revisit the traffic study on that and do a photometric to make sure the lights are appropriately spaced when we do install those.
I believe the answer currently is no. There's no additional lighting being planned south of Holland on Hahn. There is no curb gutter and sidewalk there currently, so there wouldn't be any street lights there.
Right. Right. Okay.
As development comes in, obviously, that would be conditioned to do that. Okay. Maybe on a Safe Routes to School project with Santa Rosa, it might be an opportunity, but currently there isn't. Team can look at that and see what we can come up with, but I wouldn't want to promise at this point that there would be additional street lighting there. South of Holland.
I'm sure it's a big
east
funding.
Side of Holland. Yeah,
it's a big funding issue as well. Just thinking about the big picture there. We're going to turn that intersection into a through intersection now, not just a stop sign. So thinking about what's going to happen with the traffic there. That's all.
Also, with the construction of the signal itself will have an additional street light on it.
Excellent.
It may be an opportunity now that we're thinking outside the box. To create an additional CIP project, depending on our transportation funding with this extra money that's allegedly coming, and have the city put in the curb gutter and sidewalk on that stretch, and then condition whoever comes in there to pay us back. So we could look at that too.
Discuss that, sure.
Yeah, that's creative. All right, fantastic. Anything else? Staff? Mr. Johnson? Did you get what you needed from us?
Yeah.
Or a little too much?
No, we'll take all the input we can
okay.
get.
Okay. All right. Well, I hope that August 18th is a great turnout. Fantastic. I can't wait for this to be done. Let's hope that El Nino doesn't disrupt the timeline.
Oh, jeez. Hey, you said it out loud. It's okay. It's
well, hopefully, by the spring of 2016, hopefully we'll be done with El Nino. And,
We'll see.
Yeah, we'll see.
All right. Thank you very much. Mr. Johnson, do we have anything else for the workshop?
Mr. Mayor, council members, no other items.
We are recessed until the regular meeting at 7.
Thank you.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I call the regular meeting of the Menifee City Council to order. Madam Clerk, would you please call the roll?
Yes, sir. Council Member August.
Here.
Council Member Liesemeyer.
Here.
Mayor Pro Tem Denver.
Here.
And Mayor Mann.
Here.
Thank you.
And we have words of inspiration tonight by Pastor Tony Truax, Hope Christian Church.
Right. Well, let's bow our heads, shall we? Almighty God and Father, we come before you this evening to seek your presence and your leading on our city council meeting. We ask and pray for your wisdom to be granted during the discussions and throughout all the decisions that will be made as each member considers how best to serve the citizens of Menifee. And we pray, Father, for our city's businesses, that they may be prosperous. We pray for the safety during all the construction. We pray for patience of the citizens during the construction. And we ask, Lord, for safety upon our schools as our children return in the coming days. And we also pray, Lord, for your hand of protection to be upon our first responders, our law enforcement, and the men and women who are throughout our state fighting the raging wildfires. And Almighty God, we are a people who recognize our need, and we ask for your intercession and your provision, and we humbly ask all these things may be granted according to your will for your purposes, and we ask these things in your holy name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you very much. Councilman Liesmeyer, would you lead us in the pledge?
Please. Please join me in following the Pledge of Allegiance. Ready to begin.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you all very much. We have no presentations this evening. I'll entertain a motion for approval of the minutes from the June 17, 2015 meeting. Any objection? Minutes are approved. Madam Clerk, do we have any modifications to the agenda tonight?
We do not, sir.
Thank you. The agenda is approved. On to public comment. Would you call the first public speaker?
Yes, sir. Rich Biber, Menifee Valley Medical Center. He has a flyer that is in front of you that he asked me to give to you.
Thank you.
Good evening, Mayor, City Council, City staff, and audience. My name is Rich Biber. I'm a community relations liaison for Menifee Valley Medical Center and Physicians for Healthy Hospitals. I was going to come tonight to talk about our health fair that we're having on November 7th, but I think I'll leave that for another couple weeks when I have some flyers that we've finished up. But just to give you an update, we're going to have our annual health fair on November 7th in the parking lot of the hospital from 10 till 2, and it's going to be a five-year celebration of the ownership of the doctors of Menifee Valley Medical Center and Hemet Valley Medical Center. So we're going to have a real good day. The second thing was, and I didn't plan to do this, but I saw a press release last night. It was sent to me about the City Council and CAL FIRE combining efforts on a Vial of Life program. Am I correct?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. I just wanted to update you on what the hospital has been doing through the foundation, first of all, for about the last 12 or 14 years. It started with the Menifee Valley Medical Center Foundation, and they funded about $5,000 a year to sign up people for Vial of Life. PHH, the Physicians for Healthy Hospital, 2 years ago decided to change everybody over to the Vial of Life. Now, this is a program where the sticker goes on the outside of the door or window of the entrance to your home. When the first responders or the police see that, they know that this is on your refrigerator. It's magnetized. And inside is all your information, medical information, right down to your pets. If you have a pet, there's a space there. Put the pet's name and who to call in case they got to take you to the hospital. Over the past 10 years or so, we've signed up over about 7,000 people. There's been a lot of transition. When we started sending these out to the people that we signed up for Vial of Life, we sent out over 5,000 of these. We've given out over 20,000, or just about 20,000 in the last 6 years of these. So I just wanted to update you that there is another program that you can do, and we've been doing it. And in your packet, you'll see a birthday card that we actually send out to everybody on our list once a year to wish them happy birthday in their birthday month and to tell them to redo their packets, to update their information, because your medical information changes year to year. So we do that. That's the hospital. PHH has been paying for that for the last 5 years, and it runs us about $6,000, $7,000 a year.
Mr. Biber, that's your time.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you. Next speaker, please.
Chuck Ritter.
Hello, Mr. Mayor, City Council, City staff, fellow citizens. I've been coming to these meetings since the city incorporated. Overall, y'all have done a pretty good job. I can say that, overall. However, it is our duty as citizens to keep an eye on you. We need to come here, voice any kind of complaints we have in a civil matter. And as long as we're looking out for the city of Menifee, that's the important criteria. And in that thought, I saw on the agenda for future items, you're going to be talking about bringing something back to the ballot. I have concerns about that because we worked very hard to get the city to have districts. And there's chatter going on that they're going to bring the district issue back to the ballot. I don't know how true that is, but it's being said out there. I strongly urge the city council not to do that. If somebody puts a petition out, that's a different story. So that's what I'm concerned about the most. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. There hasn't been any discussion amongst us about districts at all. It's the full council voted for to put a ballot measure up for term limits with a couple of options, and also for the mayoral term. Next speaker, please.
Michael Mudd.
Good evening, Mayor, Council, staff. Thank you for hearing me. What makes us a republic? A large aspect of our republic asserts that the law will be enforced equally. It does not matter if you are a common dishwasher or you have been placed in a position of power. The law will be applied equally. Our former council member, Thomas Furman, is still trying to dodge the local laws of this city. Mr. Furman is still operating multiple businesses from the Wooden Nickel Ranch, even after his recent convictions by the County of Riverside. Mr. Furman continues to operate without proper licensing. He continues to operate with multiple code violations. How long will it be before someone is seriously injured or worse? Drive by and you will see many horses still boarded there. You will see many trailers parked there at this property as Furman is still leasing space to owners of said trailers. The real question now is when someone is hurt, can the city sustain a major lawsuit that will surely be the consequence of Mr. Furman's non-compliance of our local health and safety codes? I have given Kathy Bennett one of the dispositions of an employee that worked for or does work for the Wooden Nickel Ranch and Tom Furman. I will supply her with another disposition tomorrow. In these dispositions, you will see that even the employees admit to the violation of Mr. Furman's property in detail. These dispositions are recent, so you will also understand that Mr. Furman has not taken the city's request for compliance seriously at all. In fact, the opposite is true. Mr. Furman continues to thumb his nose in defiance of the city of Menifee's health safety codes and regulations. The people of Menifee now ask you to take this matter in your hands and shut down the Wooden Nickel Ranch before someone is injured or worse. Here are just a few of the noncompliance issues at the Wooden Nickel Ranch. People living in substandard housing without heat, lighting, or even toilets. Substandard lighting outside. health violations, operating businesses without licenses, boarding horses, renting space, employees not paid, employed people without pay, he offers no records of salary payments to his employees, etc. Please draw your own conclusion from these depositions in order to make the right decision. Something needs to be done immediately. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Mudd. Next speaker, please.
John Voris.
Staff members of the City Council. While driving near Antelope a few weeks ago, my wife noticed a siren and a flashing light. She couldn't pull over on Antelope, so she drove down a side street. She realized that the flashing light and siren was of a fireman. The fireman pulled her off to the side of the road, and determined that she had violated a traffic law. Now, I find that quite disturbing myself. I don't know exactly what's going on. I stopped and talked to a sheriff about it, and he said that it was normal operation for a fireman to be able to do that. Okay, one of the reasons I decided to come before you guys today was because a number of years ago, I served on the Poway Unified School District Public Committee, and we investigated an incident where a student was pulled off a bus and was molested. And anyway, in the whole process, I served on this committee. And the reason I'm coming before you today is because I think that the liability of such a situation where a fireman can stop a citizen, it just seems to me that's out of hand. Now, maybe I'm wrong. Is that not the policy, that the fireman can pull someone off for a traffic violation? A fireman can stop a person for a traffic violation? I see these looks on your face like you can't believe this has happened.
Well, we're limited in what we can reply to you. So if you'd finish your statement, then I can direct staff to provide an answer or give some feedback.
Okay, there's, I'm a little nervous, so if you'll just bear with me. My wife was afraid to open the window because she knew it wasn't the policeman, okay? So that was a concern. And I will tell you, if that would have been my teenage granddaughter in a situation like that, I would have really, really been concerned. And also, given the situation and the sediment right now between the public and the police, this just seems to me like a very bad situation to encourage. Not to say anything against the firemen or not to say anything against the police, but the mixing of the two, I'm sure the requirements to be a police officer is quite different than the interviews and requirements to be a fireman. So I've worked with both. But anyway, so I guess that's kind of, I guess what I really have for you guys is a question. And am I out of line by bringing this to you guys?
No, not at all. And we appreciate you bringing that to our attention. Chief Rodriguez is in the back and can provide you some immediate feedback. Mr. Johnson, do you have anything you want to share about this? And you can step away from the podium and talk to the chief. Thank you. Absolutely.
Mr. Mayor, members of the council, I'm not aware of anything the city would do to instruct a fireman to pull over a motorist.
Thank you kindly.
Mr. Mayor?
Yeah.
I'd just like to say that I come from a long line of family, from a long line of firefighters, and I have been in audibles many times with my father and brother when he was off duty, and if they found someone throwing a cigarette butt out a window in a fire area, you could be sure that they were going to pull you over. So that's my experience with that.
Thank you. Next speaker, please.
Katie Minear.
Good evening. Gosh, Michael Mudd, you don't even live in the city and you're real concerned about our citizens. Anyway, I've been communicating with Mr. Carwin, who's our new planning commissioner. And there's been some questions between him and I and some answers going back and forth. Recently, he asked me a question. And his question was, assuming that the sludge was harmful when dumped in Menifee, is it still toxic or has that element of the sludge dissipated such that current exposure is less harmful or not at all? I'm going to read Dr. David Lewis's response. He is a federal EPA researcher, microbiologist, well-versed in this subject. He was here before this was a city, said this was the worst contamination he'd seen since Love Canal. We'd see cancer clusters, which I believe we're seeing now. His answer to this was, yes, the treated sludge is still toxic for very long periods of time after application to land. It contains highly complex mixtures of EPA-listed priority pollutants that EPA prohibits in water and air under the Clean Water and Clean Air Acts. Unfortunately, Congress never passed a Clean Soil Act. Soil, therefore, has become the unregulated final resting place for toxic chemicals that are strictly regulated in air and water. Priority pollutants, by definition, are highly persistent, harmful to public health, and biomagnified up the food chain. They include all of the leading groups of chemicals known to cause cancer, birth defects, neurological damage, and other public health problems at millions of times higher concentrations than EPA permits these same chemicals to exist in air and water. Because they are present in sewage sludge at such high concentration and are not readily soluble in water, they continually leach out into the environment over many decades or longer in trace amounts. Although they are virtually insoluble in water, they are highly soluble in animal fat. That is why they concentrate in sewage sludge, which contains a large amount of animal fat. Hence, they become biomagnified up the food chain. What do you propose that the city do now? All of the articles seem to indicate that the sludge fill is currently benign, so there is no reason to remove it all. At least that is what the recent testing shows. Whatever testing has been done could not have demonstrated that treated sewage sludges containing complex mixtures of EPA-listed priority pollutants no longer contain these chemicals once they are applied to land. All that any test can show is that the material meets standards set by EPA, which means that they're testing for 12 or 13 things. They're not testing for the combinations that all of these have.
Katie, that's
I have time. A flyer I'm going to leave with all of you, as well as Rob Johnson, who planned our bogus forum, and it lists Dr. David Lewis's contacts. And yes, Scott, for your Facebook page, cancer sucks.
It does, doesn't it? I'll refrain from commenting on that. Next speaker, please.
Ms. Miller.
That's like environmental 101.
I know it. You can do that. You don't have to go over there. Oh, that was excellent. What incredible technical speech. All right, some statistics suggest that America wastes over a billion barrels of oil a year waiting in traffic. How much decrease in air quality does that mean? How much greenhouse gas does that send to the heavens? You know, it's a fire hazard to idle your engine in a parking lot outside of a school. You know, you just left your engine on because you took your packages in the car. In the house? What's going on here in Menifee? I was just at the shopping center and I couldn't go near my own vehicle because it had been surrounded by cars leaving their vehicles on. I don't want that kind of air pollution. I'm not the disposal site of the area. And so I tried to ask them to turn them off and they just don't relate. You know, we can all take a lesson here. If you have to wait somewhere for someone, come outside and wait in the lobby of the store or the school or wait by the tree, but you've got to quit this stuff. We can't keep wasting the oil. I mean, did you like it when it was $4.50 a gallon? It's going to go back up there. All right, now I'm horrified that the city will be supporting any act by Ken Calvert. Now, So just because you're supporting it doesn't mean that it's going to be passed, and that's a good thing. This will be downsizing NEPEPS. That's part of the water pollution emissions. It will be downsizing rules on the Army Corps of Engineers requirements for more developers' buildings, and permits for Department of Fish and Wildlife may be challenged. He says they're repeating. I doubt any word he says. He's the one that caused the pollution in Corona, the backup. You can't even get around the corner to Riverside to go bark at the county about too much development, unless you start at 3 in the morning. Then you have a way to get around there. And this town is placing more hundreds of homes, which will put more traffic out there. So Ken Calvert made his living helping developers find land on roads that he got the money from his appointment at the Transportation Committee in the House of Representatives, and that's his business model. You go get elected, and then you know what's going to happen, so you go back and buy up the land around this proposed road, and you sell it for a fortune in your business of selling land to developers.
Thank you, Ms. Miller. Next speaker, please.
Those are all the speakers. You do have a speaker when you reach consent, sir.
Okay, we're on the consent calendar now, and
I think we'll do council reports.
Oh, yeah, we will do council reports. I just blew through that because I don't think I have one. Council member reports, please. Mr. August.
A question, Mr. Mayor. I have two reports tonight, but usually at the end of the agenda, we have council member comments, and I don't see that on here tonight, and I'm probably missing it.
At the end of the agenda is any item you wish to see come to a future agenda. Your council member reports or comments are now.
Well, I wanted to do that little thing on the homeless. I'll wait till the end of the meeting to do the little card.
Why don't you go ahead and
let me do one on RTA first, Mr. Mayor. Yeah, and then take a couple of minutes. Okay, on June 25th, the Executive Board of RTA and the RTA Full Board of Directors, which I'm on July 23rd, both unanimously approved honoring Wallace Edgerton for monumental contributions to RTA and the community with a bronze plaque at the bus stop located at Mount San Jacinto College in Menifee, and naming the bus stop in perpetuity the Wallace Edgerton Memorial Bus Stop. There will be a dedication ceremony at the college in late September. As soon as RTA and the city can get together and agree on a date, we will inform the public. As we know, many of you would like to attend that event. So, next, most of you, when you walked in tonight, you probably didn't see this little orange card over here. It's called a Homeless Pocket Guide. I'd like to give the credit for this guide to senior analyst Gina Gonzalez for collecting and assembling this information and making it available on this wallet size directory. It includes the names, phone numbers, email addresses, and description of emergency services for the homeless and others having an immediate need for shelter, food, clothing, and mental health assistance. As the city seems to be experiencing the presence of more homeless, it is felt that this information on this pocket guide will be very useful, not only for the homeless person or persons, but also the general public. Should you be approached or care to compassionately intervene while providing this information to anyone seemingly in need of help and assistance? If you would like additional guides or information on how to best serve the homeless and the ill effects caused by the homelessness, please contact the city. Again, thank you to Ms. Gonzalez. We are the city is continually seeking ways to assist and find facilities for the homeless. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you, Mr. August. And that's a great card, a great effort by Ms. Gonzalez, and hopefully we can get more of those distributed to the folks. Okay. Any other reports from council members since last meeting? Hearing none, we'll take move on to the consent calendar, and we'll take the public speaker on the consent calendar now.
Thank you. Ms. Miller? All right. This is a California poppy that the decisions of this council has made homeless. Too much heat. They don't grow here. Let's do 10.6. We do not approve another annexation agreement, this time with Diamond Brothers to build more homes when this developer, a subsidiary of Rancon Marietta, should know how overwhelmingly overbuilt Marietta, Temecula, Menifee already are. Thousands of more homes can't come into this area with water draining residents. Don't build, they won't come. Diamond has not met the plans for public improvement condition of approval, numbers 50, 012, 023, 025, 027. The maintenance of these public improvements will become the city's responsibility. Does that mean they are going to be using public taxes on items that the developer should pay for? 10.7, how can CRNR approve collecting more debris from additional hundreds of houses when they say we are at landfill capacity and can't recycle what we have? So don't approve their contract, which could include using some old fossil fuel trucks because of the strain of picking up so much debris from hundreds more homes to pick up the trash, or use natural gas, which extracts from a fracking process that uses very bad chemicals and passes through the aquifer, which means it poisons it. Tell Pacific Community Builders that they need to regroup, re-educate themselves in something that people need, like firefighting thousands of acres all across the United States. Anyway, let's see track number. Let's go to number 10.7. I don't have to worry about the order, really. 10.11, track number 30142.1, that green light's going off on me. This is the Garbani project, a floodplain on the east, on the south side of Newport Road. You will see hundreds more homes coming up there, 114 on 51 acres. This project does not meet the public improvements necessary for compliance to receive staff approval because it is negatively impacting water distribution, debris removal, air quality, any ability to be self-sufficient in agriculture for this city. We can't just keep putting our soil underground. So we'll do number 12 because I'm probably out of here. And you've done
that
too many
time,
on
Ms.
this
Miller.
Evening.
That
my
is
time
your time.
Is it number 12?
Yeah. Ms. Miller,
out of sure. control building. The home.
Do we have any other speakers on consent calendar?
No, sir. That would be it.
Thank you very much. I'll entertain a motion on the consent calendar at this time.
Motion to approve.
Move and approval by Mr. August, second by Mr. Liesmeyer. Roll call vote, please.
Councilmember August.
Aye.
Councilmember Liesmeyer.
Aye.
Mayor Pro Tem Denver. Mayor Mann.
Aye.
Thank you.
On to public hearings. We have a public hearing and adoption of resolution number 15-456, approving the issuance of a tax-exempt revenue bonds by the California Municipal Finance Authority on behalf of the Santa Rosa Academy. Mr. Johnson, is there a staff report on this?
Yes, Mr. Mayor, members of council. Bruce Foltz, your finance director, will introduce our partners from Santa Rosa Academy.
Thank you, Mr. Johnson, Mayor Mann, City Council. Santa Rosa Academy has approached the City Council to have a TEFRA hearing in order to take public comment regarding tax-exempt bonds. TEFRA stands for Tax Equity and Fiscal Responsibility Act, which falls under the Internal Revenue Code, and it mandates that the local authority, which would be the City Council of the City of Menifee, hold a public hearing and then adopt a resolution to authorize the sale of tax-exempt bonds. These bonds are the sole responsibility of Santa Rosa Academy. They are not the, they do not hold the city liable. They will not be part of the city's debt. and they do not affect the residents within Menifee as far as being assessed on their tax roll. So without further ado, I'll pass one on to representatives of Santa Rosa Academy. They'll give you a little further detail of how they propose to sell the bonds and the structure they plan to build.
Let's before we do that, let's follow our public hearing procedure here. You'll have the mic in just a minute. Are there any questions of the council of staff before we open up the public hearing? Hearing none, we'll go ahead and open up the public hearing at time 7:30. Madam Clerk, was this properly noticed, and have we received any correspondence regarding this?
It was properly noticed. We have not received any correspondence regarding this hearing.
Very well, then we will hear from the Santa Rosa Academy at this point.
Thank excuse me. Thank you, Mayor Mann, and to the council for allowing us to speak before you. My name is Laura Badillo, and I'm the executive director for Santa Rosa Academy, and we came before you about 3 years ago for the same purpose for the building of phase one of our school project. So we are here to update you on what we're doing. I also have with me Rich Hansberger, our attorney, and Ben Barker from CMFA, just in case you have any questions about what we're doing. So I apologize, we did not have a PowerPoint presentation. We've been down for 3 days. Our technology is not working. So you do have before you some of the diagrams. So just to let you know what exists, what we're working on, the outlined area that's in green is what currently exists at our site. So that is the elementary, middle, and high school program. As part of phase one, which that was, we also included the football soccer field. So what you see in outlined in purple is our what we call phase 1.5, and we are starting that now. We have had approval to start grading. We have several outbuildings on Sherman Road. You'll see two little buildings at the top of that little purple section. Those are storage facilities. We are adding bleachers on the south side of the property to the left of the football field. Our two buildings, one is a snack bar and one is a set of men's and women's restrooms, as well as that full area where the baseball field is. We separated phase 1.5 from phase 2 in part because we wanted to use some of our reserves to cover that expense, as well as the fact is we wanted to move a little bit faster in getting more facility space, in particular fields, for all of our students. The smaller section in blue that you see is our gymnasium, and that is what is we're looking at financing. $10 million bond is what we're looking at financing for that facility, and again, that is fully our responsibility. It is a private bond transaction. The rest of the second page of that basically gives you a little more detail as to the buildings and what we're doing on the process, as well as the third page is a rendering of our gymnasium, just to give you an idea of what that is going to look like in phase two. And then the final page shows you the gymnasium in more detail. It is going to be a three-court gymnasium, and we do have an arrangement with the city that we will share the facilities for use by your community services. We've met with several representatives of the city to talk about a facility that the community can also use. So in a nutshell, that is our project. If you have any questions, we'd be happy to answer them.
Thank you very much. Are there any questions of council at this point? No. The what's your bond rate or your credit rating right now?
Yeah, double B.
We're at double B.
Double B?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And that's my only question. Okay. Thank you very kindly. No other questions of council? Do we have any? Thank you very much. We'll take additional public testimony if we have any.
No, sir.
We have no additional public testimony. Do you have anything you'd like to finalize or conclude with? All right, then I will close the public hearing at time 7:34 and entertain a motion to adopt resolution 15-456.
Motion to approve.
We have a motion from Mr. August.
Second.
Second by Mr. Leesmeyer. Call the roll.
Thank you, council. On the motion for 15-456 adoption, Council Member August.
Aye.
Council Member Leesmeyer.
Aye.
Mayor Pro Tem Denver.
Aye.
And Mayor Mann.
Aye.
Thank you.
Thank you very kindly, and we hope we get invitations to the ribbon cutting. All right. Thank you very much. On to discussion items, agenda item 12.1. We had an opportunity as a result of Mr. Edgerton no longer being with us. We needed to make some reassignments of regional boards, commissions, and committees. And to that end, Madam Clerk, could you read the mayor's appointments for these categories for the purpose of ratification? Do you not have those?
I did not bring them with me, so how about I give that a shot? Riverside County Transportation Commission, the member is yourself, and the alternate is Mr. Denver?
Correct. Would you like me to take it from here?
Oh, would you? Thank you.
Okay. And we're for the Riverside Transit Agency. The primary is Mr. Councilmember August, and the alternate is Mr. Liesmeyer. And for the appointments to the standing committees that we have, Mayor Mann will be the Finance Committee, and Mr. Denver will be on the Finance Committee. And on the Public Safety Committee, it'll be Councilmember August and Councilmember Liesmeyer. Gentlemen, those are my requests, and I'd love to have a motion to ratify those appointments.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Roll call vote.
Councilmember Liesmeyer.
Aye.
Mayor Pro Tem Denver.
Aye.
Councilmember August.
Aye.
Mayor Mann.
Aye.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. On to City Attorney reports.
Nothing to report.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Johnson.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Members of Council, I have several items, unfortunately, but fortunately. First of all, thank you for going dark in July. I know that staff had an opportunity to not only catch up on a lot of work, but get ready for the what we believed would be a slew of applications and submittals, which 33 came in July for project work. So you'll be seeing a lot of that in the fall with the Planning Commission and yourselves on projects that are coming through. I did want to also thank the staff for doing phenomenal work while I was away on vacation. I know that the first day I was gone, there was a severe storm, and I chuckle, but staff, boy, they kept me in the loop on everything, and even with a roof falling off of a local business, got the roads back open and kept everything going for 2 days. Well, that was a crazy time. So very thankful for our Public Works Engineering Emergency Services Department and our admin services, and of course the city manager's office. Tonight on the consent item of 10-14, I did want to thank you and talk a little bit about the public work staffing transition. As you know, we pulled a contract with our former provider PV Maintenance, and I just really wanted to say thank you for looking at a close review at what we've done. We started several years ago with a contract over $1.1 million for our street crew, and that included one two-man crew 5 days a week. As we've gone over time, we've kind of whittled that down. That's gas tax and Measure A, so it's not general fund money. It's the money that we use to fix our streets, curb, gutter, sidewalk, trim trees, and do a lot of work in the public right-of-way. Last year, we managed to whittle that contract down to about $750,000. In looking at the contract and trying to whittle it down a little bit further, we could not reach an agreement with our former provider, so we went out and hired some staff. We had to transition quickly as July 1 came on, but ultimately, we will be saving the gas tax account to the tune of $425,000. That money will be put directly back into the streets. As you can see, what we've done so far with our crew of four instead of two and our two vehicles, saving $420,000 a year in a contract. You already saw them on Newport fixing some potholing on Newport that's been languishing for a while. We've taken care of eradicating a lot of weeds in the public right-of-way and in the median, so I appreciate that. So thank you for that, and you'll see a huge change going through now a uniform fitting and making sure our guys are outfitted so that they're clearly seen in the public right-of-way. Transitioning to maybe some more transportation money, I believe I talked about this in June, but I really want to do a recap because it kind of happened at the end of June, early July. The governor's proposing some new funding for transportation and roads, And of course, you know how that all comes to us through additional taxes, of course. He's proposing, and I believe when the legislature comes back, California on the 17th of August or 18th of August until September 11th, they will have an opportunity to work on this transportation needs and roads. The governor's looking for $6 billion in revenue, which would keep our roads throughout the state at a pavement condition index of 66. So we're not going to do a lot of improvement with $6 billion. However, $3 billion of that comes to local agencies. $75 million would go to Riverside County, and based on our population, the city of Menifee would be eligible for $4.3 million annually for the next 10 years. That's $43 million that would be coming to the city, specifically set aside for roads, streets, and infrastructure. So if we're looking at any opportunities to really get Scott Road financed and done, there you go. Holland would be completed, Bradley Road complete. So we're looking at a nice share of funds. We'll know. Yes, it's going to be a tax increase at the pump. That's going to be vehicle and registration fee increases. This is what the proposals are to raise that dollar amount. And the alternative fuel vehicles would then be taxed, which they're not now, because if you don't pay at the pump, we don't get those funds. And so we should know something by the end of session in September. So we're looking forward to seeing that. The other update I have is SB 25, which is our vehicle license fee funds. Did get re-referred to Committee on Appropriations. It passed 9-0, and it's most likely going back to the governor's desk again for the third time in a row. And yes, he could veto it again. However, he could pass it as well. And the third option is we continue to let our state legislature know that we're in need of those funds back. And so even if we don't get them back this year, we have another opportunity. We'll go back next year, and we'll go the next year, and maybe when there's a new governor, if this governor doesn't see what we're missing and replace that the next governor will. So that's good news. Two other items of note. The International City Managers Association contacted Menifee and identified us as one of the top 25 cities in the nation to come and interview us on our infrastructure and economic development gains in this area, since we are a newly incorporated city and have made great strides in our infrastructure development and our economic development activities. They will be down here next on the 12th, producing a 5-minute film for us and interviewing some key staff as well as the mayor. And then that will give us national exposure at their ICMA national seminar. So that's kind of unique to us and nice. And finally, maybe one of the most difficult conversations to have is when a city manager talks to the council about opportunities to increase revenue and what that might look like. On July 28th, the city of Temecula went through a post-budget adoption workshop where the city manager brought several items to the city council to discuss and get some ideas on how to move forward on. They were tough topics. A sales tax ballot measure, a utility users tax ballot measure, a public safety tax initiative, a community services district fee, and a TOT or hotel tax increase. And this is Temecula that I'm talking about, not us in particular. I have talked to a few of our key staff, Bruce Foltz, Jeff Wyman, Gina Gonzalez. We're prepared to come back to council to share what they've shared so that you can hear what another city that's 20 years older than us is facing now. We talked in January and February about some legacy items. These are some things that may not happen to us until the future, but we should probably start thinking about now how we're going to compensate for those things. And we're also going to throw in there probably a discussion about the new infrastructure financing district, which even if we put it in place now, you wouldn't be seeing the fruits of that for another 5 years. So those are things that will be coming back most likely in September. We do have a community services update to tell you all those great things that are going on in July. And since we took over from Valleywide, some good statistics and some programs that we have. So I'm going to turn it over to Robert for the balance of the item.
Thank you, City Manager. Good evening, Mayor and members of Council. Just a few things to run over this evening. I know it's been some time since you probably had heard about what we've been doing. I'll go over new staff, some maintenance issues, and capital improvements and class and activities that are new for the department and for the city. Some important dates, though, if you're interested in attending, August 6th, which is tomorrow night, there is Family Fun Night at Lazy Creek. This is the second of three that we're doing this summer. It starts at 5 p.m. For any families that are interested. We do have National Night Out that's occurring on August 8th. It'll be in the city of Paris this year, and I know the city will, our city, many of you will have a presence there. And then Movies in the Park is also on August 8th at La Ladera. One of the Muppets movies will be screened. It'll be the final in our movie series. We've been seeing about 200 to 300 people at each screening, so it's been a good event. And then school's back in session on the 17th of August, believe it or not. So I know a lot of kids are probably a little bit bummed about that, but it does mark the end of our busy season. And the 21st is when we are anticipating having all of our new Youth Advisory Committee applications due. We will be hitting the schools once they're in session on the 17th to remind them of those due dates and hoping to get some good applications this year. And then finally on the 27th, we do have a senior center open house where we will be showcasing a lot of the new activities and classes that will be offered coming forward in fall. The new staff, if you didn't have a chance to attend the grand reopening event at the Case Cineceros building that was in July, these are the folks that have joined the team. We do have three staff dedicated to maintenance, Mark Cooper, Bryce Howell, and David Brooks, all come with a lot of experience in maintenance, particularly in landscaping. And then on the recreation side, another team of very capable individuals from various cities around us. We have folks from Marietta, Montana, all very well established, and decided to make the leap over to Menifee and help improve our programs and activities, as well as 13 part-time community service leaders who we brought on board for summer programs. Finally, we also support all of those activities with an office worker at our main building by the name of Edna Aguilar. On the park maintenance front, we have instituted a work order system that does track and maintain all of the repair requests that come through. It does include routine as well as deferred maintenance projects that are in process right now. In the month of July, we had about 75 tickets for service, and these are the various categories. We're still sort of going through how we're going to be categorizing these moving forward, just determining which are going to be most frequent, which ones are most prevalent, as well as things that you don't see on here yet may surface later, things like tree trimming, which are certainly seasonal as well. Some of the capital improvements, again, if you missed the Case Cineceros building opening or reopening, I should say, some of the improvements in the interior and exterior are quite significant. ADA improvements, new AV system, transitioning office space into multi-purpose rooms to help with spillover or overfill of the senior center into the adjacent West Annex building, which is the home of the new community services headquarters. Exterior improvements, re-slurry and stripe of the parking lot, ADA improvements there as well, landscaping that's now drought tolerant and brought up to date and up to code. It's going to hopefully make a big difference in our utility bills moving forward as well. Along the capital improvements line, we are preparing a five-year park CIP plan, which we intend to bring back to council at a future meeting. And currently are finishing up an inventory of the park and trail conditions to help round out that list. Again, it's 5 years. We're also researching grant opportunities to help offset funding for those improvements and then prioritize those improvements. The Parks Commission will be taking a close look at that at their next meeting and then making a recommendation for council's approval of that list. And some of the activities that the city manager was discussing earlier include a lot of enrichment programs at the senior center that we've taken over from the former contract operator. Numbers are up, obviously, because it is summer, but Lazy Creek camps continue despite the transition. There was a lot of uncomfortableness in the community, but the new staff have made that transition as seamless as possible and started brokering good relationships with the community members. And I think you may recognize this slide from a prior update. We did go live with ActiveNet, our online registration and reservation system, on May 20th. Since then, we've had gross revenues of about $36,000. Activity registrations have yielded about 293 enrollments, and facility reservations about 54 permits. That's not 54 rentals or reservations, that's just permits that may have recurring uses in all of those facilities that we have. So these are overall very good statistics. We are looking to see this obviously increase as the year goes by, but this already is above what we had experienced with the contract operator during the same time in the previous year. And that concludes my report.
All right.
Thank you, Robert. I had one final item that I neglected to update council on. There was a meeting that Mr. Leesmeyer and I attended in Temecula, talking about consulting services to conduct a comprehensive police services study. That has resulted in a draft RFP that we are a part of with seven other cities in local in Riverside County. And we are moving forward with gathering information on that study. Don't have any other items.
All right. Any comments from council members? Mr. August.
I don't have to speak on those two issues.
No.
Okay, thank you. Anyway, just thinking, I wanted to give a special thanks tonight to Public Works and Jonathan Smith, and also Colin McNee and Code Enforcement over the past several months. Both of your departments and you people have been personally involved with people's concerns out in the community. Your team and yourselves have been very timely and responsive and constructive with the people in District 1, and I'm sure with other districts around the city. And nothing makes my job more easier and more rewarding than for the staff to work for the people in that community. So I want to thank the staff, everyone. So I appreciate that.
Thank you, Mr. August. Mr. Denver.
As you know, I'm involved, my wife's really involved with the Arts Council of Menifee. And there's any number, twice a month you get to see a number of you've been there. Over at Case and Aceros, they put up all the art inside the building, the new art. And we have a whole bunch of some very talented artists in our area. Well, one of the things that I've been really looking for and finally started seeing is Menifee-centric art, stuff that talks about the history or the area of Menifee. And so there was an article in the Inland Empire magazine. The title of it was Tree of Progress. If you'd go ahead and put that up. I happen to have a copy of that. And it's, this magazine put this up, and this is the going to be someday famous Menifee oak tree. And so it was taken, a picture was taken by a Walter Santos, and these are made into both brochures and all kinds of things, and they're coming up more and more different things that are Menifee-centric. And all I would encourage you is that when you see something that's about Menifee, that's art, and if it interests you, buy it so that we get the people more interested in doing Menifee art. That's really all I
is that think. Is that the oak tree at the
that's
town
the
center?
That's the oak tree.
Wow,
yeah.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Denver. Mm-hmm. Mr. Leesmeyer, tonight?
I wanted to ask. It's probably not appropriate, but you can shut me down if you want. The speaker that came forward tonight asking about the fire marshal who made a stop.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't know if we wanted to publicly address that or not, or if that was
not on the agenda. Well, let's get a. Yeah, well, I think Scott's
I don't know what to say about that.
I didn't know if maybe Charlie or George could say something about it. I don't know.
Let's plan it a little bit better. Okay, and maybe we'll get it out to us that way.
I just don't want people thinking we have rogue fire marshals running around.
Yeah,
in there.
I know they have a little bit of authority, so we'll see how that goes. Mr. Johnson, you had mentioned road repair and things that begged a question. I was driving down Menifee Road a few times this week, and it reminded me, what's the timing for the installation of the lights at Menifee and Aldergate, Holland and Bradley, and Garbani and Antelope? It seems like they've been ready to go in for a long time.
They have. There was a bit of a discrepancy with our fine contractor who had promised a particular date that they would be installed, and that got moved out by about 3 or 4 weeks. Is that correct? So where we anticipated the second week of August, right before school, it looks like it's going to be the first week of September, and they will both be installed.
After school starts?
Of course.
Are we going to get any money back from them for failing to deliver on the contract?
They will be under liquidated damages.
Okay. I think we should go after it. Mr. Leesmeyer.
Yeah, I want to piggyback on your Aldergate light there. Do we have a speed survey completed yet for the missing link? Or do we have that in the works? Do we need to get
the speed survey for missing link was completed. The signs are up, correct?
Correct.
Yes, they're done.
The speed survey was done. Public Works is in the process of getting up the signs. Okay. I don't have an update in front of me as to if they actually have those up there on Menifee Road. I was told that they are. So yes, the speed survey was done. We had a meeting a few weeks ago with the Sheriff Department to address not only Menifee Road, but the other roads in the city where our speed survey covers and the signage that will be changed out.
Excellent.
Cool. That's all right. All right, there we go. Anything else from the council? I too want to echo what Mr. August said. I think from my perspective, going dark in the month of July has been a benefit for on a lot of levels. People get a chance to take vacation, decompress, clean out their desks, resurrect projects and things that they wanted to get done. And also, I think it was a good break for us up here, for us to regroup and to clear our heads and get ready to do the business of the city from a policy standpoint for the rest of the year. So I too just want to congratulate staff on all the fine work that you're doing, and let's just keep it up. And with that, we are adjourned.